of virtual water trade in Canada, the very first in the country, that's going to show that Alberta is exporting way more water in the form of virtual water. That is the trade in wheat, grains, livestock, and of course for the oil industry, than it has. Already we know that Alberta has, with only 2% of the available fresh water in Canada, is supplying 60% of the water for agriculture that is leaving the country. So there is no place in our country that you can say all is well and you know, we don't need to worry. This is a worry for others in other countries. I want to say one last thing and then open this up. I want to give, because I'm speaking to a lot of educators and particularly a lot from Ontario, we have a very particular fight at the Council of Canadians we need your help on. I was in Chile not long ago and was told Chile went from a totally public water system, that's water services, wastewater services, to a totally private in the space of 10 years, from 1997 to 2007. And the single biggest investor in this private water system is the Ontario Teachers' Pension Plan. And I am outraged about this. And I have to tell you, we met with the Ontario Teachers Federation, and I was so upset I got up and left the meeting. It's just very unlike me. I usually can keep my cool. But I was getting arguments like, and this isn't from the pension fund, we know where they are. This was the executive of the Ontario Teachers Federation. We were told, everybody does it, we have to look after the bottom line of our members. If it's a duly elected government, if they decide to go private, that's none of our business. If we were to leave, somebody else would make money from it. And then I said point blank, okay, let's pretend instead of talking about private water, that we were talking about private education. And the Ontario Teachers Federation was investing in private education in other countries. Now, they knew I had hoisted them on a petard, right? Because truly, it would not be consistent to say no to that and yes to private water services. So they gulped deeply and said, yes, if it were a money-making project and it was a democratically elected government, we would invest in private education in other countries. That was from a meeting we had with the Ontario Teachers Federation about a month ago. So we need your help on this. Anybody wants to work with us on this, we would really, really welcome your support and help. We, again, on our website, we have a petition. We're trying to get some media for this. We've had a difficult time, and I'm not sure why. That pension fund is really sacred. It's really a sacred thing, you know. It's there making money, and it can just go into all sorts of dreadful things around the world. Let me tell you, we are in a struggle in our world to maintain what we have of public space, the commons. You know what they want to do with cap and trade? Do you know what cap and trade is? It's making derivatives out of air pollution and selling it and making money, and offsets are just so big, rich corporations in the global north can continue to pollute while they pretend to plant trees somewhere, but they're eucalyptus trees in countries that don't have any water. I mean, this is... We have to challenge the notion of globalization, market-based, I call it savage capitalism, and I'm not against trade, and I'm not against the market. If they would behave and live by the same rules the rest of us have to, or pay the same taxes the rest of us have to. But this notion of unlimited growth is killing our planet, okay? There's an American environmentalist who says that the concept of unlimited growth, which is what all of our policies are based on, all of the Harper government policies and the liberals before them, all of them, are based on the notion of growth. The DNA of growth, of unlimited growth, has, or this concept has the same DNA as the cancer cell. Mm-hmm. It has to turn on its host in order to survive. We cannot continue to do this. We have to live differently. It's going to mean living more locally. Most importantly, it's going to mean more local, sustainable food production. It's going to mean saving and protecting the wild spaces, protecting and honoring water where it exists, and restoring what we've destroyed. If we don't change our notions here, we're going to see more oil spills like we're seeing that we're all watching on television unfold and knowing what's coming. And we owe this to the next generation, and it's not for us to turn to you and say, well, you guys, over to you. That's not fair. We owe it now. to bring in the kind of laws and the kind of far-sighted policies that can change this. Martin Luther King said, legislation may not change the heart, but it will restrain the heartless, which I think is beautiful. I will leave the formal part of this with two quotes, and then I think we'll have 10 minutes to talk. The first is my gorgeous quote from Carl Sagan, the late great American environmentalist and folk scientist. He said, anything else you are interested in is not going to happen if you cannot breathe the air and drink the water. Don't sit this one out. Do something. You are, by accident of fate, alive at an absolutely critical moment in the history of our planet.
That's right.
Gorgeous. And the other's from Tolkien. I kind of have Tolkien on the brain when I talked about Alberti's tar sands being moral. When we had our annual general meeting in Edmonton 2 years ago, we took a group of people up to the tar sands on a sightseeing mission, and then I flew over them in a helicopter. And it's really, it's the death of nature. And if you remember Lord of the Rings, Mordor is the death of nature, and that's why the trees come and they fight back, you know. And it was really funny because I had said this about a law and a lady in Alberta, right? And this head of this company said, which was a dumb thing to say, he said, it's not as bad as Mordor. And I thought, what, half as bad as Mordor? Half of all nature just died, that's okay? Like, you've taken down a boreal forest the size of Greece, and you're going to take five more down, and that's okay, right? I mean, he should have said there was no Mordor connection. Instead, he allowed the Mordor language to creep in, and now it's stuck with them. So, Tolkien, this is Gandalf, and Gandalf is facing that terrible night you will remember in the book and the film, where all good things, all living things may be destroyed by this evil force. And so he talks about being a steward. And I just want to say, I know I'm in a room full of stewards. I know every single one of you is here because you care about that out there, and you care about the next generation. And like First Nations people, you're going to care for seven generations on. So he says this about stewards, and I just want to leave you with this. He says, the rule of no realm is mine, but all worthy things that are in peril, as the world now stands, those are my care. And for my part, I shall not wholly fail in my task if anything passes through this night that can still grow fair or bear fruit and flower again in the days to come. For I too am a steward. Did you not know? Thank you.